is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takacs, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another episode of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takacs, your podcast co-host. We have a cool episode for you today. It's titled Wisdom from Jim Collins. If you're a regular listener to the Thriving Dentist Show, you know that Jim Collins is one of my favorite authors and one of my favorite thinkers. And I'm going to share some information about wisdom from Jim Collins that can be adapted to your practice. I think you're going to love this episode. Hey, before we get to the episode, though, a couple quick announcements to make. Number one, coming up, we have a masterclass that I think you might be interested in. This masterclass is coming up on October 13th from 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern Time. It's a three-hour masterclass. And it's titled, Six Steps to Successfully Resign from PPO Plans. A masterclass is a three-hour course that allows me to take a deep dive in a narrow topic. And of course, the topic is how to successfully drop PPO plans. Come join us. I'll present the six very specific steps that can serve as a blueprint for you. We've now done this hundreds of times in practices all over the country, and we've refined it down to literally a blueprint to follow. You know, the masterclass is done in a live stream format, meaning that you attend virtually from the comfort and convenience of your home or office. However, we do it live, so you can interact with me. We do limit attendance because I run it more like a workshop than a lecture. Even though it's virtual, we limit attendance because we do run it live more like a workshop. And all of our master classes have sold out. We expect this one to be the same. If you'd like to register, go to thrivingdentist.com/masterclass. Tuition is less than $100. We try to make it as affordable as possible. And you'll get 3 hours of CE credits. I hope to see you there. Hey, the second announcement that I have for you is that we've got a guest contributor, Dr. Jeffrey Deuce, and he is going to kind of share a tip with you on how to apply the Stephen Covey concept of thinking with the end in mind when it comes to cosmetic dentistry. And in particular, he's going to share a couple of awesome tips on shade matching. Boy, you're going to love his insight on this. With no further ado, here now is Dr. Jeffrey Deuce.
Good morning, everyone. You know, I'm standing outside on my deck and looking at the Long Island Sound and enjoying the beautiful weather. And I was thinking to myself, what tip could I give people on a Sunday morning that would make maybe their life easier this week? And I've come up with it. You know, Stephen Covey thinks about or talks about thinking with the end in mind. And many times when we do our restorations, we really don't know how we want this restoration to look other than beautiful, right? We're trying to do beautiful dentistry. So when it comes to shade matching, remember, always take your shade before you start your procedure. Because as you do your procedure, the teeth actually dehydrate and become lighter. You can be off by two shades. But there's another thing to remember. The color is made up of three components: hue, value, and chroma. What do you think the most important one is? It's the value. Because the grayness is what can mix you up. So what I do when I do composite restorations on anterior teeth, I take a number of shades and I place them on adjacent teeth before I start the preparations or before I start the procedure. And that tells me how I'm going to mimic that tooth and make it beautiful. So remember, take your shade before you start your procedure and enjoy your Sunday. Because I certainly am outside on the beautiful Long Island Sound. Bye for now.
Welcome back to the Thriving Dentist Coaching in Action segment. This is Naren, your co-host. Dr. Jeffrey Deuce, thank you so much for your wonderful tip. This was very helpful, and I'm glad you tied it back to Stephen Covey, because today Gary's going to touch on Stephen Covey as well. Our topic today, everyone, is the wisdom from Jim Collins. All of us know Jim Collins. I'm sure many of us have read his book, the famous one being Good to Great. I know Gary has done a book club around the book Good to Great with all of his clients. And I love Jim Collins. I think I read Jim Collins' books, I think going back 15 years ago, and it had a profound impact on me as I built my business from nothing, a startup to, you know, 200 plus team members. So Gary, I can't wait to get started on this episode where you're going to share specific ideas, strategies from Jim Collins that are applicable to dental practice owners.
Yeah, I'm excited about it as well, Naren. You know, I think Jim Collins is one of the all-time great business thinkers. You know, I think of him as a brilliant strategist and a brilliant thinker, and all of his books are fantastic. You know, we're probably most familiar with his book, Good to Great. That was a New York Times best-selling book. But I've heard Jim say himself that his favorite book is actually not Good to Great, but it's Built to Last.
That's the first one I read, Built to Last.
Yeah. Built to Last actually is a book that Jim Collins wrote about companies that have not only succeeded for over 100 years, but have figured out how to thrive in radically changing conditions and have lasted and been brilliant companies for more than 100 years. And that was called Built to Last. You know, when I first read the book, Good to Great, when it came out, and it is one of my all-time favorite business books, Paul and I, my dentist business partner and I, actually used that book as a blueprint to follow in our first year of practice ownership. We read that book together and we decided to literally use the wisdom of the book Good to Great in our first year. And we applied it, you know, every day in our practice. So it was that experience, the positive experience we had in my own practice, where we took that Good to Great concept and adapted it to dentistry. But then also a recent event we did with my clients. We do regular online events for our clients, and we did one recently. It's called Practice Driver. It's something that can drive your practice forward. And we recently did a practice driver that was all about the flywheel effect. And the flywheel effect came, you know, from the book Good to Great. And we had such a positive reaction from our clients about how they can use this, like literally like today in their practice, that it inspired me to do this podcast episode. So if you're not familiar with Jim Collins, I'd like you to get familiar with him, read or listen to his book, Good to Great. By the way, if you choose the Audible version, Jim actually narrates it himself. And I always like it where the author narrates their own book because they emphasize the stuff that they think is most important. So it's kind of like it becomes a passion project to read the book, you know, to narrate it because they can emphasize the things that they like. And we're going to talk about how to apply all this to your practice. So first, I want to talk about the flywheel effect. Now, I want to kind of frame it visually for you. And I know this is obviously podcasts are an audio exercise, not a visual exercise. But I want to actually kind of frame this visually for you. Imagine a massive wheel, a massive wheel. It's a wheel of stone. And imagine that it weighs 2,000 pounds. And it has an axle. And you're trying to get that wheel to turn. You know, imagine that it's kind of, you know, the wheel isn't touching anything. It's held up above ground. And you're trying to get this 2,000-pound wheel to turn. And you can imagine, Naren, the difficulty in getting your first momentum to get that wheel to start to turn. But you push on it, you push on it, you push on it, you push on it. And, you know, it's making imperceptible movements. But you stay after it. You don't give up. You keep pushing. And finally, it starts to move a little bit. And then it moves a little bit more. And then it moves a little bit more. And then it moves a little bit more. And finally, you've taken it an entire rotation. And imagine that you stay after that. And you keep pushing and pushing. At some point, the wheel starts to turn. And it develops momentum on its own. And it's unstoppable. It's unstoppable. Because the momentum from that 2,000-pound wheel turning is what Jim Collins calls the flywheel effect. Now, his analogy in business is all those imperceptible pushes on the wheel are the little things you do in your business that will improve the business. By themselves, it seems like a little thing. Like, you know, you move that wheel, 1/16th of a turn. It doesn't seem like it makes much of a difference. But you put a bunch of those 1/16th of a turn together, and next thing you know, that wheel is unstoppable.
You know, Gary, so, go ahead. That is an excellent point, Gary, that you're making, because, if I look back at my career, you know, over the last 15 years, we started with one person, and today we have 200 people. And it's really, we don't do 10,000 things. We do like 10 things, right? And what you call 1/16th of the wheel really well. And we get better at those 10 things. And I think every dental practice has the same thing. There are few things they have to do every single, like for example, Google reviews or excellent marketing. They just have to keep at it and just get better and better and better and better. You know, if they do that, success is just a byproduct of that, you know, 16 pieces making the wheel move automatically.
Right. Well, and, you know, in the book, Good to Great, Jim Collins identifies companies in the Fortune 500 that made the transition from a good company to a great company. And only 11 companies made that transition. They were all in different industries. They're from 11 different industries. Only 11 out of 500. He used very specific analytics to define what made a great company. And these were analytics. And only 11 made it. And what he did with each one of those companies is he contrasted the company that made the transition from good to great with another company in the same industry that did not. And he contrasted it. And the contrast, so the one that did make the transition from good to great used this flywheel effect. The company that didn't, he characterized the opposite of the flywheel effect was what he called the gloom doom loop. The gloom doom loop is where something starts to imagine, you know, something circling the drain, you know, where, you know, something happens, something negative happens in your practice, and it you know, it's challenges, it's you know, we're struggling, and you know, our momentum stops, we get distracted, and all of a sudden it becomes a circling of the drain leading to more and more failure, rather than, you know, the momentum, the positive momentum of this 2,000-pound flywheel turning. It's the cumulative effect of the negative momentum that happens that really adversely affects your business, or in our case, you know, adversely affects your practice. So you want to stay out of the gloom doom loop. You want to be always on the flywheel effect. Now let's talk about some things that relate to the flywheel effect as applies to your office. I think of our 24 systems, at each and every one of those as being those small little things that by themselves don't make much of a difference, but when you start to put it together, it makes it turns that 2,000-pound flywheel. Mastering Google reviews, using Whitening, you know, as a gateway service. I'll just rattle some systems off. Having a scheduling template that allows us to achieve our daily goal every day. Having a collection system where we collect everything we produce. Having a regular format for team meetings. And I could go on and on. I could list all 24 of those. All 24 of those systems are part of the momentum that moves that wheel and then allows you to hit breakthrough. So the graphic that Jim shares in the book is, imagine a horizontal line, you know, just a straight line of your business progress or your practice progress. It just kind of keeps chugging along. And all of a sudden you get the hockey puck effect. Naren, you're familiar with being a Canadian. If you're not familiar with the hockey puck, I'm going to be terribly disappointed in you. What does the hockey stick? What does the hockey stick effect mean in business?
Yeah, it typically means that it's an exponential growth. Like, in other words, like just like the hockey stick.
Well, think about what a hockey stick looks like. It's got a small blade, but then a long stick.
Yeah. And it goes really up, right? I mean, if you look at a graph, it goes up, which means
higher than a 45-degree angle. Fast.
Yeah, exactly.
It's maybe more like a 60 or 70-degree angle. So what Jim Collins talks about is, as you're starting to make progress in your, I'm going to use dental practice, as you're starting to make progress in your practice and you're doing these little things, they don't seem to be having an effect. But if you keep at it, and you know that wheel is beginning to turn, all of a sudden you'll hit a point where it's breakthrough. And then the breakthrough isn't just a little bit of improvement. It's breakthrough that more looks like, you know, a 70-degree upward angle on the curve. But why do practices not hit breakthrough? Why? So I'll go to the second part of this discussion. So I hope this is all making sense. Why would a practice not hit breakthrough? The number one reason why a practice won't hit breakthrough is they get overwhelmed by distractions. Hey, and let's face it, that every practice on the planet is going to experience distractions. Mine, yours, every one of our listeners. Maybe we're having trouble hiring. Maybe we've got some HR issues in the practice. Maybe our marketing isn't quite firing on all cylinders. Maybe we've got the need for more technology, but we aren't financially successful enough to yet invest in more technology. So we all gonna hit distractions. The practices that make breakthrough deal with the distractions while continuing to make progress on the flywheel effect. They don't let the distractions they don't let the distractions derail them. They don't let them.
So another way, another way maybe people can think about this, Gary. I heard of somebody who's late, Chet Holmes. He talks about companies that are successful, and he said the most successful people in companies, they don't do 10,000 things. They do 10 things 10,000 times, whether it's Google reviews, whether it's whitening. They just find out what those 10 or 5 or 6 or 15 things, and they do it again and again. So what you're saying is, to create the breakthrough, you need to find out what your X number of things are. I know you work with...
Well, let me get very specific with it. It's the 24 systems and the 9 KPIs. It's the 24 systems. The systems are what create the foundation of your practice. And then the 9 KPIs, and by the way, all of the 24 systems support the 9 KPIs, 9 key performance
indicators. So you're saying those 9 KPIs are like the part of the flywheel. And as long as, like one of the KPIs is, number of Google reviews, how many teeth whitening cases you did you complete this month?
So, well, Google reviews is a great example. Google reviews is a great example. So what we often see with our clients is, we teach them a system for consistently getting more Google reviews, and they light up to it, and they dive into it, and they start to see great results. What I mean by that is maybe the office has historically gotten 2 reviews a month, which is pretty much pathetic. Let me just put it that way. It's pathetic. But now we teach them a system to pay attention to Google reviews, and now they're consistently getting 14 Google reviews a month. That's a common end result that we see. And they do it for a couple months, but then they get distracted on something else, and next thing you know, they're not doing Google reviews anymore, and they're back down to 2 a month. That's a practice that will never hit breakthrough because they got derailed by the distractions. And it's a matter of, deal with the distractions. You can't stick your head in the sand and pretend they're not happening. Deal with those, but don't let them derail you. Continue to always be working on practice development, which leads me to the next point from the book. And this is, I'm going to bring in an influence from Stephen Covey that relates to this. Stephen Covey makes a big distinction between that which is urgent versus that which is important. And one of the comments that Stephen Covey says, and I believe this with every ounce of my DNA, never let something urgent distract you from that which is important. Let me give an example. The phone's ringing in your practice, and on the surface, that is something that is urgent, because if we don't answer the phone, it could be a new patient, right? Yes. And we might miss our opportunity for a new patient. So the phone ringing is urgent. But it may not be important because it could be a telemarketer. Does that make sense?
Yes.
So urgencies in your practices are the distractions that come up. Yes, they're urgent. But never let them get in the way of spending time and attention on that which is important. So another really important distinction. Pay attention to understanding the distinction. How do you spend your time? Do you spend your time on urgencies, or do you spend your time on things that are important? You want to spend you have to spend some of your time on the urgencies, but you want to spend most of your time on things that are important. And now as we wrap this up in the coaching and action segment, I'm going to bring one more concept out of wisdom from Jim Collins. And that is the what he called the hedgehog concept. The hedgehog is a small little animal. Kind of looks like a little squirrel with bristly fur, kind of like a porcupine. And the hedgehog, the reason he uses the hedgehog has an enemy, a natural enemy. And Naren, the natural enemy of the hedgehog is the fox, Hedgehogs are common in the UK. So we have listeners in the UK, you guys know what hedgehogs are. And they're very common in the UK. And the hedgehog has one survival technique, to not get eaten by by the foxes. And that is, when a fox is approaching, it rolls up into a ball, which makes the spines stick out like a porcupine, and the spines deter the fox. So it has one survival technique. So how that relates to the book Good to Great and dentistry is he talks about the hedgehog concept as being the intersection of three circles, where three circles intersect. The three circles are, number one, imagine a circle, which is something that you are passionate about, What is something in your practice that you're passionate about? Another circle is something you can do really, really well. Jim actually characterized the book as something that you can do at the world-class level. So this is something you can do clinically in your practice really, really well.
And then he uses the phrase best in the world.
You call it best in the world, right. The third circle is what drives your economic engine. So, and the intersection of those three circles is where you should be spending your focus on. Something that you're passionate about, you can do world class, and it drives your economic engine. Let me explain that last part in simple English. It's profitable. So let's say there's something you love to do, you're actually really good at it, you don't make any money at it. That would not be something you want to spend your time on because it doesn't meet the intersection of those three circles. So think about something that you love to do clinically, that you can do really well, and that you make a profit at, and that's where you want to spend your time and attention in your practice. And it's that hedgehog concept that, that can be a wonderful contributing factor to you really taking your practice to breakthrough, The key is it's in the flywheel effect. Get that flywheel moving, get it moving imperceptibly at first, get it moving, and don't get distracted. Deal with the distractions, but don't let the distractions derail you from moving and keep working on it. And you'll eventually hit the point that's breakthrough. And that's where we start to see geometric results in your practice. Not just a little bit of improvement, but geometric results. Well, I hope this has made sense. I hope I've motivated you to take more interest in the thinking of Jim Collins and actually applying it in your practice. We have some great questions coming up about the wisdom from Jim Collins in the Q&A segment. Let's hit pause here, and we'll come back and answer those questions.
Welcome back to the Thriving Dentist Q&A segment. Gary, I do have four questions for you. Let me start with the very first question I have for you. I share your interest in the book Good to Great. I especially appreciate the flywheel effect. I seem to be stuck right now in the build-up stage, and it feels like I'm spinning my wheels and yet to hit breakthrough. Any suggestions on how to break out of this rut?
Yeah, so again, let's come back to that graphic that our question relates to, and that's the graphic in the book about the flywheel effect. And the build-up stage is a flat line that goes horizontally, and it's build-up, and then at some point, you hit breakthrough, and breakthrough is where you get the hockey stick effect, where all of a sudden, that horizontal line goes up at a very steep angle. And so what I heard the questioner say was that he's in the buildup stage and seems to be stuck, he or she seems to be stuck and is yet to hit breakthrough. And
so would like just to clarify, Gary, when you say the flat line versus that, you know, growth phase, you are talking about, let's say, the monthly collections.
It feels it has more to do with your more of a, it's not specifically analytical. It has more to do with I'm doing lots of things to develop my practice, but I'm not seeing results.
Okay.
So it's not necessarily related to very specific metrics. But it's, I'm, you know, like for example, I bought a CERAC machine and it doesn't seem to be helping my practice, you know, or, hey, I bought a laser and that doesn't seem to be, you know, that by itself didn't take us to breakthrough. you know, those kind of things. So it isn't necessarily metrics. So it's a horizontal line. You know, you're developing your practice. And he called that buildup. And then at some point, all the cumulative effect of that flywheel moving hits breakthrough, and then the practice accelerates rapidly. So what I heard the questioner say was that he or she seems to be kind of stuck and wants to know if I have any recommendations. Did I hear that correctly?
That is correct. So in other words, it feels like I think he's doing all the components that are part of the flywheel, and he's still not getting the breakthrough yet.
Yeah. Well, remember that that flywheel may be moving imperceptibly. You know, right. Everything we do has an effect on it, you know, in a positive way, and it may be moving, but it just hasn't gotten that momentum to hit breakthrough yet. So keep after it. And it may be that you're being distracted, you know, you're experiencing distractions that's taking you away from practice development. You know, you might be the practice that, you know, for a couple months was serious about Google reviews, and then you got away from it. Or maybe whitening was something that was on your radar screen, and then you got away from it. Or you did morning huddles for a little while, didn't seem to work, and you got away from it. So you've got to stay consistent with it, and you've got to keep momentum going, keep moving. Think progress, not perfection. Progress, not perfection. But stay after it. Deal with the distractions. You know, if you're shorthanded, then part of your energy ought to be spent. You know, that's urgent. You're shorthanded, and so you have to deal with that. You have to, you know, make sure that your ads, whether it be on Indeed or DentalPost.net or ZipRecruiter, are current, that you're reposting those, or at the top, you're responding to any applicants that you get. So you have to stay after it. Don't get derailed. You can get distracted, but don't get derailed. Derailed means that we kind of throw our hands up and give up. Don't get derailed. So just stay after it and keep, you know, working on things. Go back and work on some of the things that you've already done and you know, keep adding to it. Add, you know, new focus. Maybe it's a new system. Maybe it's advancing a current system in your practice. So keep after it. And you will hit that breakthrough. Yeah.
Right. I have experienced the breakthrough in my career, you know, my business. You know, like once you get the breakthrough, you might be growing 20, 30, 40% a year. And, you know, you will really feel it. But like you said, you have to do a lot of prep and a lot of work till you get to that breakthrough.
You know, it's been our goal to grow at least 10% a year, at least 10%. I call that double digit percentage growth. So at least 10% growth a year. But there have been years where we've had growth in the 20s, you know, 26%, 28%. And so those are when the breakthrough is really kind of, we're seeing the results of all the buildup. And that's when you hit those breakthroughs. So you bet. So I just want to be encouraging. I want to be encouraging to that doctor that stay after it because it's like when the flywheel first starts to move, it's imperceptible at first. And you're thinking, is it even moving? But in fact, you know, it's that momentum that's going to get it to breakthrough.
Makes total sense. Let me ask you the second question, Gary. One of my challenges right now, and I believe this to be common among my colleagues as well, is that I'm short-handed. How can I continue to make progress in practice development when it seems like we are all so stretched?
Yeah, that's a reality right now. It's the time we're recording this. You know, we're recording this at the end of August 2022. And by the time it airs, it's going to be in September of 2022. And doctor, if you're shorthanded, you've got a lot of company out there among your other dental colleagues. And by the way, not just in dentistry, businesses all over are shorthanded. Naren, you know, if you visit restaurants, almost every restaurant has a sign in the window, help wanted. You know,
yes.
Brick and mortar stores aren't, they're kind of going away. Brick and mortar stores, retail. But I bet there's many retail stores that have help wanted signs as well. I heard recently, you know, talk about another segment. There's a tremendous shortage of teachers right now. And in many cases, school districts are radically short of the teacher headcount that they require. So this is a reality that we're in right now. I don't believe it's going to be permanent. I believe it's there's many factors contributing it, but it's a reality right now. First of all,
before you answer the question, I do have a question because you shared with me that you read in the news that things are starting to change. For example, major corporations are laying off people, you know, not just like Amazon. What can you talk a little bit about that? Like,
yeah, this is fresh. This is something, I listen to podcasts when I listen to business podcasts when I'm running every morning. And just this morning, on my 8 mile run, I was listening to a prominent business podcast, and there were some predictions about massive layoffs coming up. That Amazon's going to be laying off, that Walmart, Target are laying off. We're possibly going to be experiencing, some layoffs, and that might change the job market radically. There might be people looking for jobs. Now, granted, be open to hiring someone without dental experience. Be open to hiring someone without dental experience. So specific tips, and I don't know whether that prediction is true or not. I could see I can see some signals that might indicate that that's what we're going to experience coming up this fall. I would hope not. I don't like people to lose their jobs, but the fact that there might be people looking for jobs might make the job market change favorably for us to be able to all of a sudden have applicants that we could hire from. That might work, in our favor, although I don't certainly wish any hardship on anyone from the loss of a job. A couple things. Keep your ads. The three platforms that we found to be most productive in my client base are Indeed, dentalpost.net. If you're not familiar with that, that's a brilliant general job board. And then ZipRecruiter. ZipRecruiter has also proven to be effective to find people. And you might want to include some provocative language in your ad that says something like this. If you're looking to join a private practice and be part of a brilliant team, this may be the perfect career opportunity for you. So I'm convinced, many good people are already working. They're already working in jobs in dentistry, but maybe they're not happy with where they are. So put that provocative language in that Indeed ad. If you're looking to join a quality dental practice with the focus on quality care and the patient experience, this may be the perfect career opportunity for you. And just keep at it. The second recommendation I'm going to have is consider outsourcing. Jobs can be outsourced. There are domestic outsource resources here in the United States that can help you with outsourcing, where they can handle, especially administrative tasks, they can handle many administrative tasks, and they can provide kind of a stopgap for you so that you can continue to do all the vital functions of your practice, but not necessarily do them in office. They could be done through outsourcing, quality outsourcing. And there's some dental-specific outsourcing firms that can help you greatly. And that might be another resource while you're shorthanded. Even while you're shorthanded, you still want to make continuous practice development progress. You never want to stop developing your practice. Naren, once that flywheel stops turning, let's say it stops, then right. Can we agree it takes tremendous momentum to get it moving again?
Oh, 100%. You have to like move heaven and earth to get it to move again.
So you never want to stop that moving. Yeah.
Yeah. Absolutely. And I love that tip, Gary, where regardless of what's happening around you, regardless of all the challenges you have, you need to keep that flywheel moving and work on those key pieces that are going to keep your flywheel moving. Let me ask
and
you
acknowledge,
the question, Gary.
Acknowledge to your team members, too, that you understand that being shorthanded is causing stress on the practice. Acknowledge that. Don't stick your head in the sand and pretend that's not happening. Acknowledge that.
All right.
And recognize your team members. Recognize them, in terms of praise and appreciation and gratitude. But, it also wouldn't be a bad idea to, put a restaurant gift certificate, in their cubby and just say, hey, something, a certificate for manicure and pedicure. Hey, these are challenging times. Do something nice for yourself. Here's a little gift from the practice. Go out of your way to recognize your team members in material and non-material ways.
Perfect. Thank you, Gary. Let me ask you the third question. Stephen Covey provides so many useful lessons. His concept of the distinction between urgent versus important is new to me. Can you give some specific dental office examples?
Oh, great question. And by the way, I'm happy to introduce that distinction. And again, I want to give Stephen Covey credit for it. I learned it from him. But it's the distinction between that which is urgent versus that which is important. And I would encourage you to go on Google and look up, you know, what do we do today if we want to learn something, Aaron?
We Google it.
We Google it. So Google Stephen Covey and call it the urgent versus important quadrant, time quadrant. And you'll see the graphic about it's a quadrant. You'll see it graphically. And he gives four different quadrants. The horizontal axis is that which is urgent. The vertical axis is that which is urgent. The horizontal axis is that which is important. And he comes up with four different quadrants. That'll help you understand it even more. But I want to answer your question very specifically. And one of the examples, I'll use a couple of examples. One of the examples is, this one fits really nicely, scheduling. So if we have openings on the doctor's schedule today, that would be something that would be urgent and important.
Right.
Do we agree? So if that team member drops everything they're doing to work on filling the openings on the doctor's schedule today, that would be in what Stephen Covey calls it's actually quadrant one. It's urgent and it's important. It's quadrant one.
And he calls them crises. Ideally,
it's
you
a crisis.
Want, yeah,
yeah, it's quadrant. A crisis. But it's quadrant one, which is, by the way, not the best place to spend your time. The best place to spend your time is quadrant two, which is important, but not necessarily urgent. So here's the distinction when it comes to that scheduling example. The team member that shows up to work on Tuesday morning and realizes there's openings on the doctor's schedule today, and that team member drops whatever they're doing to try to fill those schedule openings, would be something that is a crisis. And that's quadrant one. However, if that team member looks ahead to next week and she looks at the doctor's schedule and she said, next week needs a little bit of work. I'm going to work on that proactively before it becomes a crisis. I'm going to work on it while I have time this week for next week. Now we're in quadrant two. It's important because, you know, the schedule is the most important thing that happens in the practice. But it's not urgent because it's next week. But if we wait till it is urgent, then, you know, we'll get to a crisis point. So there's an example of an activity in the practice that is the distinction between that which is urgent, versus that which is important. Let me use another example from dental practice that fits into this distinction between that which is urgent, which is that which is important. One of our systems is for the doctor to always have a 3-year master plan for his or her big CE. Big C, not the everyday stuff, but the things that you're working on that will take a while to accomplish. Maybe you're working on earning a fellowship in the AGD or a mastership in the AGD, or you're working on becoming accredited by the AACD, or maybe you're working on different fellowships related to your implant journey, your dental implant journey. And so that often gets sort of put aside, Naren, because CE is never urgent, is it? Is CE ever urgent, Naren?
No, it is not urgent, Gary.
No, it's not, because, you know, you can show up tomorrow without having had taken your CE.
Right.
But it's very important. Because if we always put it off, you can get into a rut where all of a sudden you're taking the minimum amount of CE to keep your license. And that simply doesn't match up with a world-class practice. You know, one of the characteristics of world-class dentists is they take a massive amount of CE, many, many, many times over the number of hours that are required to keep your license. And that's a common denominator among world-class practices. So that would be another example of watching your behavior, how you spend your time. You should spend some of your time on planning your master calendar for the 3 years out for your big CE. By the way, part of a nuance of that is every year you lop off the year we just completed and you add a third year onto it. So you always have something that's stimulating you in CE. You always have something that you're working on. And you're embracing the concept of simply being better tomorrow than you are today, which, by the way, has all kinds of byproducts in your practice, because if you're modeling that to your team, then they're going to follow in your pathway, and they're going to follow your model of always wanting to be better tomorrow than today. So there's another really good example. Do those two examples make sense, the scheduling example and the CE example?
Absolutely, Gary, it does. And I want to add a couple of points based on my knowledge of my experience with Stephen Covey's concept. Those people who are successful work on the important and not on the urgent more and more. And little by little, the crises, the urgent slash important, becomes less and less of their schedule. And the things that are not urgent and not important, totally ignore. I mean, they get good at, like, for example, watching TV or, you know, like dilly-dallying. Like, those things are not urgent, not important, but we just waste time.
That's quadrant 4.
They do that less and less and less. And then, of course, they also don't do the things that are urgent and not important, like an unopened mail.
Right.
It looks urgent. You're like, oh, what's inside that mail? Like, I want to open it, but if that's not important, then you can schedule it and do it at some other time.
Right. You're absolutely right.
Thank you, Gary. I think this is awesome. I love the two examples, dental-specific examples of how to work on more things that are, you know, important but not urgent. Let me ask you the last question, Gary. This is the fourth question. Using the hedgehog concept, one of the clinical areas that meets the intersection of the three circles for me is cosmetic dentistry. However, as a PPO practice, it does not drive my economic engine. Why? Because of the very low contracted veneer fees. What are your thoughts? What are your strategies, Gary?
Well, doctor, you actually did a very good job of understanding the hedgehog concept, because you've got two of the three circles. Two of the three circles. It's something you're passionate about and it's something you're good at. But because of the low fee schedule that you are required to follow as a PPO provider, it doesn't drive your economic engine. You don't make any profit doing it. In fact, you might even look at this. You might even discover that you actually lose money because of the lab fee for doing quality veneers. You might find that you're actually losing money. So the solution to that is to develop a plan to drop those PPO plans. You know, one of the insidious parts about being a PPO provider, and this is something absolutely drives me crazy, is the fact that PPO plans can dictate your fees on services that are not covered under the plan. Porcelain veneers, for example, adult orthodontics, or implants, dental implants. However, if you're a PPO practice, you're going to have those fees defined by the PPO plan. And you're obligated to charge those fees, even though they're not covered by insurance. That's never going to change. That's not going to go away. So the best thing that you can do is to set up to plan to successfully drop PPO plans. And I'll bring this back full circle to an opening announcement that I made. If you're interested in that, come join us for that masterclass. It's coming up on October 13th, 6 Steps to Successfully Drop PPO Plans. Come join us for that. You can go to thrivingdentist.com/masterclass. By the way, doctor, if you can drop those PPO plans, then in fact, cosmetic dentistry is going to lie at the intersection of those three circles. Something you're passionate about, something you do really, really well. And now, because you can charge an appropriate fee for it, it will drive your economic engine. So the solution is to drop those plans. Well, as we come to the finish line today, I hope this has been of interest to you. I hope I've inspired you to learn more about Jim Collins, read the books, and embrace the concept of the flywheel effect. Don't get derailed in your build-up stage. Don't let anything derail you. Keep working on it. Keep working on it. Keep working on it. And you will hit breakthrough, I can assure you. I've seen it happen so many times. And sometimes the breakthrough part is just, you're sometimes at the give up point right before breakthrough. You know, it's like right before breakthrough, you think, oh my gosh, this is just too hard. Maybe I should just settle. And then you decide, no, I'm going to stay with it. And then you hit breakthrough. So just let me encourage you to stay with it. Hey, as we wrap up today, I want to take a minute and thank you, Naren, for being the podcast co-host. Also, thanks to you and your team for all you do to support my Life Smiles practice with with our dental marketing. By the way, if you'd like to master dental marketing yourself, I would encourage you to go to equa.com/MSM, where you can schedule a marketing strategy meeting and learn how Equa can help you master the world of digital marketing. I also want to thank all of our listeners. We appreciate each and every one of you. I have a favor to ask. If you'd be kind enough to tell a colleague or a friend about the Thriving Dentist Show, we'd be very appreciative of that. We appreciate each and every one of our listeners, and we'd love to have even more, and we'd love your help with that. Hey, thanks in advance for doing that for us. On that note, Naren and I look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride, don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. When you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.